been forgiven, risen, we living to give them our all. Rise up from your past that's holding you down. This moment is all that matters, the future is now. How will the people know if we don't tell them? If we fail them, they stumbling in the dark, but the light is what we carry, yeah. Don't have to wonder your purpose or what you here for. Reflect his image and show the world what he cares for. And I know it's all right, 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 you know, and you know it's your lie, lie, lie. And we know the time's running out. Can't wait around, cause seen plenty of hatred, death, and destruction where ignorance kills many. The blind leading the blind, we turning the blind eye. That alone is a crime, we got the power of life. I know that we make mistakes, don't let them keep you away. Mercy, love, and His grace, the reason we move ahead. Speak out, though we never been qualified to do it. I ain't earned it, I was loved into it, I'm brand new, yeah. And I know it's all right, 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 you know, and you know, it's your lie, lie, lie. And we know, the time's running out. Can't wait around, cause
draw you near. So come. to the hero and the coward, to the prisoner and the soldier, to the young and to the older, all who hunger, all who thirst, all the last and all the first, all the paupers and the princes, all who failed, you've been forgiven, all who dream and all who suffer, all who loved and lost another, all the chained and all the free, all who follow, all who lead, anyone who's been let down, all the lost who have been found, all who've been labeled right or wrong, to everyone who hears this song. Come to the table, come join the sinners, you have been redeemed. To the table. I've walked among the shadows, you wiped my tears away, and I felt the pain of heartbreak, and I've seen the brighter days, and I've prayed prayers to heaven from my lowest place, and I have held your blessings, God, you give and take away. No matter what I have, your grace is enough, and no matter where I am, I'm standing in your love. On the mountains I will bow my life to the one who set me there. In the valley I will lift my eyes to the one who sees me there. When I'm standing on the mountain, I didn't get there on my own. When I'm walking through the valley, I know I am not alone. You're God of the hills and valleys, hills and valleys, God of the hills and valleys, and I am not alone. Watch my dreams get broken, in you I hope again. No matter what, I know I'm safe inside your hands. On the mountains I will bow my life to the one who set me there. In the valley I will lift my eyes to the one who sees me there. When I'm standing on the mountain, I didn't get there on my own. When I'm walking, God of the hills and valleys, hills and valleys, God of the hills and valleys, and I am not alone. Father, you give and take away every joy and every pain. Through it all, you will remain over it all. Father, you give and take away every joy.
Welcome everyone to Kaleo Church. We're so glad you've joined us here today. And we want you to know that you're not here by accident. God has a word for you, and we believe that you're going to leave inspired and changed by the gospel of Jesus. Amen. We are a church. Kaleo Church exists to see people changed by the gospel of Jesus. We believe that we will be remade, refilled, and released. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, as we get started, I wanted to give you a little bit of an idea. We know this online format is a little different, but we want you to worship freely today. We're a church who encourages people to worship God with freedom and with passion. So even in your house, as you sing, as you get together, man, just worship God today. Shout amen. Sing along with us, if you will. We want you to do that today. There's a couple things in this format that you'll really like. There's a prayer button. If you need prayer, you can hit that prayer button at any time, and one of our hosts will pray with you individually. We'll get in a separate chat with you, and we'll pray with you individually right there. There's a button you can press at any time. You can see it there. And if you want to send a specific prayer request to the pastoral team or just to me, the pastor, or even our prayer team, there's a button that should be popping up on your screen right now. You can press that and fill out the little form, and you can send a prayer request to us that way. But we do want you right now, something should be coming up on the screen. We want you to invite people right now. We want you to invite people to join us in online worship. Maybe there's someone sitting at home right now who needs to hear a word from God this morning, and your simple post on social media will encourage them to jump on and join us and hear from God today. So I want you to invite people right now. Send them a text, send it on social media, send them an email, call them, whatever you need to do. Just take a moment and invite someone to join us today. And lastly, before we get into worship, if it's your first time or if you want more info about something to do with our church, there should be a button popping up right now. Hit that button, and we would love to get to know you, and we would love for you to get to know us a little bit. So hit that button, fill that out, and we would love to talk with you further. If it's your first time, we're glad you're with us. But let's join now in worshiping together. We want to welcome you this morning to Kaleo. We're glad you're here. We know it's not perfect. We wish we could meet together, but we are thankful for technology and being able to see one another and chat with one another, even in the midst of this pandemic. So we want you now just stand up and let's worship together. If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old hole inside, there's a better life, there's a better life. If you got pain, he's a waymaker. If you need freedom, testify, testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, he's a prison shaking savior. Lord, you break the chains, God. You break the chains so we can worship you today. We can worship you however we want. Cause this is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how. Cause this is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how. Yeah. Yes, it is. Oh, this is how we fight. Yes. There's a table that you prepared. Presence of my enemies. It's your body and your blood you shed for me. This is how I fight my battles. Oh, and I believe you overcome, and I will lift my song of praise for all you've done. Surrounded, it might feel like everything is going wrong around us, but we are surrounded by the Son of God, by the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, who chooses to fight for us. Of the battle, we fight on our knees in the name of Jesus. We know that no victory comes by our strength, by our might. Your word says not by might, not by power, but by your Spirit, Lord. So this is how we fight our battles. God, we'll pray in the midst of our battles. God, we will serve in the midst of our battles. God, we will forgive in the midst of our battles, Lord. We just want you to be lifted up. So God, less of us and more of you. Less of us and more of you. You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies. Till all my fears
I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Chosen me, yes. Love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. 'Cause I'm no a child of God. Sons and the daughters, so we know when you call us out on the waves that we can go, God. We don't have to be afraid.
Baby.
faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the water wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander. My faith will be made stronger in the presence of my
much that your spirit calls us. So we just worship you right now in this place. God, we ask that you would continue to speak to our hearts and to our minds. God, we thank you that in you we have victory. And we've already seen that in our lives, and we will continue to see that. So God, we just ask that you give us the strength and the courage to stand up against the enemy and all of his lies and schemes. God, we pray over sickness. Break unity in our world. God, we know that there's nothing that the enemy that will throw at us that we haven't already, that you haven't already defeated. And that same spirit lives in us. So God, we ask that you give us the strength to stand up under whatever attack it is, depression, anxiety, fear, addiction. God, you've already overcome that for us. So we thank you and we praise you today. We worship you, God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, worship band, for that. We praise God. He is amazing. Hallelujah and amen. We love you. Thank you guys so much again for being here. And we just want you to know, we appreciate your faithful giving during these tough times. And we want you to know now, there are multiple options to give. You can give online at our website. You can give in the app. You can text to give. In fact, there should be a button popping up right now that helps you give that way. You can still send checks to the church, physical checks or money if you want to donate that way. To the church, we appreciate your giving. It helps us to do so many things. But let's take a moment right now, even online, and let's just greet one another. Let's talk to one another. Let's make sure everyone's doing okay. So let's take just a couple moments and greet one another right now. Couple quick announcements before I get into my sermon. I just want to let you know, if you do not have our app yet, or if you have not checked out our website, you can go right now. There should be a button popping up that you can download our app. You can check out our website. There's so many great things you can do in there. Check that out. This entire service will be uploaded to our YouTube channel, and I will share that YouTube video on Facebook if anyone wants to go back and watch it or share it at a later date. And we also want you to know, we're doing virtual Celebrate Recovery Recovery every Saturday night at 7 p.m. at this exact same website, kaleotulsa.online.church. It starts at 7 p.m. So if anyone has any hurt, habit, or hangup, we'd love to see you there. Invite someone to that as well. A couple things we got going on during this time where we have to be apart, ways that we can stay connected. We are doing a Secret Santa, and there is a form on our app and on our website. If you go look for that, it should say Secret Santa. Fill that out. And I just want to be clear, you'll get a lot of information about what people like and what they collect and the types of food they eat, things like that. You do not have to buy them one of all of that. Now, if I am your Secret Santa, if you have my family, you can buy us all of those things if you want. But in general, you don't have to buy all that. You just pick a couple things that you know they'll like. You bless them throughout this time where we're apart so we can stay connected. Another way we're going to stay connected, if you're not in our church directory yet, we're going to ask everybody to reach out to one person a week and just check on them, just pray for them, just make sure they're doing okay. So if you're not in our directory, you can also go to our app or our website and you can get on our directory that way. And if you're not invited, you have to be invited. So if you're not invited, just text me or message me and I will invite you and I'll let you be a part of that. So we want people to be in our directory so we can reach out to one another. And don't forget, starting tomorrow, Monday morning, every day at 8 a.m. and 8 p.m., we will have Zoom meetings with one of our leaders. And that's just simply for you to get online, talk to someone, pray with someone. If you need ministered to, that is a time for you to come and be a part. Or if you just want to hang out, 8 a.m. and 8 p.m. every day. The only times we won't do that are Saturday nights because we have our Celebrate Recovery service and Sunday mornings because we have our normal church service. But every other time at 8 a.m. and 8 p.m. we have a 30-minute slot that one of our leaders will be online to talk with you, pray with you, minister to you, whatever you need in that moment. We'd love to talk and pray with you. And lastly, before I get into my sermon, Hannah and Benny Kosar have set up a little place where we can take Christmas pictures and do fun things. It's right in our front door, and it's on the glass, so you can stand. We got the light on at night, so you can stand there in front of the front door, take some family pictures, take fun pictures, whatever you want to do. All we ask is that you post them to social media and tag us in them. Tag our church, tag Celebrate Recovery, tag me personally if you want. We'd love to see those and get to know you. So that's our announcements. Things coming up. Please stay connected. We do not want to feel disconnected during this time. It's the holidays. It is the Advent season. Today is the first Sunday of Advent, and we want to be connected and love on one another in relationships. So please, please stay connected in all of those ways. I love you, church. Let's get to the Word of God. Well, again, welcome. I feel like I've welcomed people like 20 times today, but welcome again to Kaleo Church. Again, we are a church that exists to see people changed by the gospel of Jesus. We will be remade, refilled, and released. And we are in this series. This is the last week of our series, Thankful No Matter What, this season of Thanksgiving. Most of us probably ate too much on Thursday. We're still maybe feeling it, eating some of those leftovers, hopefully. And we may want to just skip over to Christmas, but this season is so important, especially for us as believers. What does it mean to be thankful no matter what? What does it even look like? And if you have your Bibles, turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 9, and we're going to start, we're going to read a little bit, just one verse, verse 11, and then we're going to go on and we're going to start in verse 10 and read through, or verse 6 and read through verse 15 later on. But 2 Corinthians chapter 9, starting in verse 11, even just the first half of verse 11 says this. This is Paul talking to the church in Corinth. He says, "You will be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion." So we see here, this is interesting because Paul says, we will be enriched in every way. Every way. We'll be enriched in every way. We'll be, why will we be enriched? So we can be generous on every occasion. In other words, we can be thankful no matter what because we are enriched by God every day so that we can be generous every day. And I was thinking back to my junior high days and growing up, and I've shared with you guys many times, but I had some anger issues and some things that went on in my childhood that really caused me to kind of struggle in some ways at school. And I remember I had gotten in a fight at school, and I was struggling, and I was mad, and I could not get over it. And I remember they sent me to the counselor, the school counselor, to talk with her. And I remember as I was in the room, she was talking through, and she was asking me about stuff that I've been through, and I didn't really want to talk to her because I didn't trust her. I didn't know what her intentions were. And, you know, for me, I always kind of assumed in some ways some people had bad intentions. And so I was struggling to really talk. But she did say something that has stuck with me forever. It's a phrase that I've preached on before. It's a phrase that some of you have heard over and over. But she said, "You know what, Jason, I know you've lived a tough life." And then she said this to me: "I want you to know that there is a way, and it's a saying, and there's a true saying that is so true." She said, "Hurt people hurt people." And I know we've talked about that a lot, and I know I've even used that in some of my sermons, but there's a truth to that hurt people hurt people. If I'm hurt, if I'm struggling, if I can't get over something, then I tend to project that. I tend to hurt others, either in the same way or in a different way that I'm acting out. Hurt people hurt people. It was the first time I'd heard that phrase from anyone, and I remember it just stuck with me because I thought, man, the pain that I've gone through, the struggles I've had, I can tell that I am projecting them. I'm using that. That anger lives inside of me, and it wells up. Hurt people hurt people. And that became my life for many years. For a long time, hurt people hurt people. Even after I was a Christian, I couldn't get over some of my insecurities. I couldn't get over some of my anger. I couldn't get over my over-competitiveness. I remember different times in all of these situations that hurt people, the hurt person being me, would hurt people because of what I had been through. That was my life for many, many years. But I was thinking as I studied for this message, this final kind of to put a bow on being thankful in this season, I was thinking about this idea: if hurt people hurt people, shouldn't blessed people bless people? I mean, if hurt people go out and hurt others, if we're a byproduct of the things we've been through and we struggle and we therefore want someone else to struggle, or maybe we don't want it, but we somehow project that onto others, if hurt people hurt people, then shouldn't the blessed people be blessing people? Shouldn't blessed people bless people? And to be honest, that's what we're going to see in the scripture today. And that's my one point. If you walk away with nothing else, remember this: blessed people should bless people. Blessed people should bless people. Amen? Someone's hype amen. Someone shout hallelujah. Because blessed people should absolutely 100%, no doubt about it, blessed people should bless people. So what about you? Where do you fall in that line? Are you still hurting people out on your own, out of your own hurt? Or are you blessing people out of the overflowing blessings you have received? Were you picked on when you're younger, so now you have trouble making real relationships with people? Or do you know that the God of the universe has given you people in your life to relate with? Did you grow up around substance abuse, so now you can't seem to live without that drink or that drug? Or do you think that God, or do you thank God that He blessed you with people at Celebrate Recovery and at this church to walk with you and hold you accountable? Did you trust the wrong guy or the wrong girl in a relationship, and now you're taking it out on your current relationship? Or do you thank God every day for the blessing of knowing that someone chooses to be with you? Are you a hurt person hurting people? Or are you a blessed person blessing people? Are you a hurt person hurting people? Or are you a blessed person blessing people? Or maybe there's a third option: are you a blessed person who's hoarding the blessings? Because I think that's even worse. Are you a hurt person hurting people? Are you a blessed person blessing people? Or are you a blessed person who's hoarding the blessings? Because blessed people should bless people. Amen? So let's stop for a moment and just share a time where you have been blessed by God, because we've all been blessed by God in one way or another. Let's type it out as we're in online worship today. Let's type out just different ways that we have been blessed by God. Whatever it might come to mind, how have you been blessed by God today? Let's take a moment. Man, thank you for sharing that today. I appreciate that. I know I look forward to reading those, and I just am blessed by knowing how everyone else is blessed, and I know that I have been blessed myself in so many ways. But let's dig into the Word now. If you have your Bible, 2 Corinthians again, chapter 9. We're going to start in verse 6 and kind of break it down as we go. We're going to go all the way to the end of the chapter, which is verse 15. So if you have your Bibles, turn there today. 2 Corinthians chapter 9. Starting in verse 6 says this. Again, Paul talking to this church in Corinth. Paul says, "Remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously." And this is one of those verses that's easy. It's an easy way to get people to give. Every preacher who preaches on giving usually preaches this passage. Whoever sows generously will reap generously. If you sow generously, you'll reap generously. If you give money, you'll reap money. If you give relationally, you'll reap relationally. If you give emotionally, you'll reap emotionally. It's a simple concept. It's pretty straightforward. And it's not something that takes a lot of breaking down, but it's this idea that whatever we sow, we will reap. So if we're sowing bad, we'll reap bad. If we sow good, we'll reap good. In whatever way you want to take that, whatever it might mean. But let's move on. Verse 7, Paul goes on. He says, "Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver." And this is one of those verses that people who don't believe in tithing, they tend to point to this verse. But this is not a verse, in my studies, this is not a verse against tithing. This is a verse speaking against those who would only give or only tithe because you are supposed to, quote unquote, you're supposed to. But the truth is, the true follower of Jesus doesn't have to have their arm twisted to be generous. Why? Why is that? Because they know the promise of what's coming up in verse 8. They've experienced this promise in their own life. Look at verse 8. Verse 8 says, "And God is able to bless you abundantly, that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work." Listen to that. So God is able to bless you, not just a little bit. God is able to bless you abundantly so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. That's a powerful verse. It's a powerful verse about giving. It's a powerful verse about reaping what you would sow. It's a powerful verse about being a cheerful giver. God blesses us. He gives us all that we need so that we can do every good work He has called us to do. In other words, blessed people should bless people. Amen? Someone say amen. Someone shout hallelujah, because blessed people should absolutely bless people so that we can do the good work that verse says. So what is that work? What is the work that Paul is talking about here? Look at what it says in verse 9. As it is written, they have freely scattered their gifts to the poor. Their righteousness endures forever. So what's the work? What are we talking about? We've been blessed so that we can accomplish the work that God has set out for us. What is that work? We see there in verse 9. Our work is that we give to the poor. Listen, I know it's not the fun thing that you're thinking. Our good work is that we give to the poor. Now, does that mean we give money to everyone we meet who might have less than us? Not necessarily. See, some might be poor relationally, and we can provide friendship. Some might be poor vocationally, and we can help connect them with a job. Some might be poor emotionally, and we can help them to recover. We can be that shoulder to cry on. Some people might be poor financially, and we can help there as well. But poor does not always mean money, and generous does not always mean we have to have money in order to be generous. Honestly, probably the most generous and thankful people you know aren't the wealthiest people you know. It's entirely possible to give generously with limited means. The first person that comes to my mind when I think of that is my grandma, who I talk about all the time. Bless her heart, rest in peace. She just died in May. She's in heaven now. I praise God for that. But my grandma is this perfect example of someone who lived on a very meager salary for a lot of her life. She lived only on Social Security. Certainly when I knew her and when I lived with her, all she had was Social Security. Yet she was probably the most generous person I ever knew. I've told you stories of her eating peanut butter and banana sandwiches and one half of a nutty. This is crazy to me. How do you eat? You get a nutty bar or nutty buddy, I think they're called now. But she would only eat one half. She'd eat one of the two in the package. If I open a package, I'm eating both of them. But she wanted to save. She was generous. She did what she could. My father-in-law is the same way. He saved and saved and saved his whole life so that now, as he's living, he never scrimped or saved on giving. Giving to missions. Giving, I know for a fact, he helps fund our church. He helps fund his church at his house. He supports missionaries overseas. My father-in-law is another one that I think of. You don't have to have this just amazing amount of money in order to be generous. Some of the most generous people you know aren't the wealthiest people you know. That verse said in there as well, they have freely, listen to that, they have freely scattered their gifts to the poor. See, if we look at what we have as something we've earned, we tend to hold on to it really tightly. We become what I call, some of you have heard me say this, we become blessing hoarders. But if we recognize that God blessed us with the ability to make money or to be an emotional support or to know people who have jobs or whatever, when we see it that way, when we recognize it for what it is, it's natural to see ourselves as stewards of what He has entrusted to us. One of the keys to thankfulness and generosity is knowing that everything belongs to God. We have to see it that way. We have to know that every good and perfect gift comes from above. It's from God. See, if we think of it that way, it changes our perspective about the blessings we've been given. Mark tells us about a rich young ruler in Mark chapter 10 who comes to Jesus looking for eternal life. What do I have to do, he says, to get eternal life? What do I need to do? And Jesus tells him to go and sell everything he has and give the proceeds to the poor. And since he had so many possessions, this guy walked away dejected and seemingly not inheriting the eternal life he was looking for. See, sometimes we can hold so tightly to our stuff that we can't obey what God is telling us to do. I want that one to sit for a second. Sometimes we can hold so tightly, we can grip that stuff so tightly, we can hold so tightly to our stuff, we can't obey what God is telling us to do. We don't even recognize that as we give to others, God blesses us many times with joy and thanksgiving. We're told by our consumer culture that we'll be happier with the more stuff we have. But Jesus calls us out of that culture. Jesus calls us to generously give what we have. What we don't see is that when we trust him in this idea, when we trust him in this thought, when we obey him in the idea of being generous, he blesses us. We're not called to suffer through giving to others. Remember, he loves a cheerful giver. But we won't see the blessing in our giving until we learn to be obedient in our generosity. Blessed people should bless people. Amen? Blessed people should bless people. Let's look at verse 10. Verse 10 says, "Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness." Verse 11, "You will be enriched in every way." Again, he's saying it again. You'll be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. So we're blessed. Then we bless others. And what's the result? We saw it right there. Our generosity, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God, in thankfulness. Not only will the receiver, the person who's been blessed, be thankful to God for him providing a need through one of us, through you, through me, you will be thankful to God for getting to be a part of something, of providing for someone else something that they need. I promise you, that old saying, it's better to give than to receive, I didn't always understand that. Because when I didn't have much, I wanted to get what I could. But the truth is, now I still don't have that much, but I give out of what I have. And I feel so much better watching my kids. I feel so much better watching my family members. I feel so much better watching someone else receive than I do. Because the cheerful giver, when you give, God blesses you with this joy, with this abundance. He blesses you with this life of just knowing that he's given it to you, and you give it away, and you get to bless someone else. I remember even when I got saved in ninth grade, I don't think I fully understood this concept, but there was a moment that I seemed to grasp it even for a short time. But I've told some of you guys about this kid that impacted my life on the trip when I went to Cincinnati and I got saved. And there was this kid that I was so worried about my life and all the things that I had gone through. And this kid it's so much worse than I did. And when we went on this trip, part of our money that we gave went to getting these really nice hoodies with, I think it had our names on it, or at least our initials or something. It had our logo for our youth group. They're really, really nice, really fancy hoodies, probably fairly expensive if I had to guess. And I remember as I was about to leave and I was going to see this kid, I was about 14 or 15, I think I was 15 at the time. This kid must have been like 8 or 9, so he was quite a bit smaller than me, quite a bit younger, but I remember just the clothes he was wearing. I could tell, I never had school, I never got to buy school clothes. No one ever paid for that. I always got hand-me-downs. I told you guys, usually from my cousin who's about, three sizes bigger than me, so I always wore it. That's why I like the baggy clothes, just who I am. So if you don't like it, get over it. Sorry. But I remember I didn't have, so this hoodie was something that was very nice to me. I was excited about it. I was glad to have it. I was going to wear it a lot when it was cold outside. And but I can remember seeing this kid, and it was cold when we went. It was in March. It was still cold there in Cincinnati, and he didn't have much of a coat or anything like that. And I don't know, I'm just going to give credit to the Holy Spirit in that moment as I got saved, and he led me to do this, because it wasn't me, because I wouldn't have done that in my thinking, in my flesh. I wanted that hoodie, but I gave this child my hoodie. And I remember the look on his face of this hoodie that was probably, he was probably 4 or 5 years away from even being able to wear it right. But he just felt so honored and so loved. And so, I mean, he just fell. I gave him a big hug. He just fell into my arms. And I remember, I don't know if I did or not, but I remember getting teary-eyed and feeling like just so blessed that I could even make someone or be a part of someone feeling like that and blessing someone in that way. And it just reminded me that blessed people should bless people. Amen. We should bless people. We should. And I wonder today, as I tell that story about myself, have you ever blessed someone else? We talked earlier about, when we wrote down, have you ever been blessed by God? Have you ever been blessed by someone else? And I want to take a minute right now and just type out again. I want this to be interactive where we're talking together. I want to take this time. Have you ever blessed someone else? I want you to, have you ever given them time or relationship or emotional support or even money or food or clothes or whatever, and you've seen the difference in them almost instantly? I want you guys to take a moment and just share that right now. Type it out so we can share these things with one another. Have you ever blessed someone else? Thank you again for sharing. I know that seeing that is such a blessing for me, as I know I'm going to get to read through some of those. So thank you guys for sharing that. But let's, as we finish out this section of scripture, verse 12, Paul says this to, again, this church in Corinth, this service that you perform, that's talking about being blessed and then giving to the poor, this service that you perform is not only supplying the needs of the Lord's people, but is also overflowing in many expressions of thanks to God. Because of the service by which you have proved yourselves, others will praise God for the obedience that accompanies your confession of the gospel of Christ, and for your generosity in sharing with them and with everyone else. And in their prayers for you, their hearts will go out to you because of the surpassing grace God has given you. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. See, God doesn't just want to bless us so we can meet our own needs, but he does it so we can meet the needs of others. As we give generously in Jesus' name, the recipients thank God, not us. They won't thank us for the gift. They might say thank you, but really they understand that it's from God, because we say, hey, I've been there too. I've struggled. God bless me, and I want to bless you. It's God blessing you right now. So God bless you. And when we do that in the name of Jesus, when we give generously in the name of Jesus, maybe it's through the church, maybe it's what you do out on the street, maybe it's who you see and you give generously in the name of Jesus, the recipients of that blessing will thank God. See, gratitude doesn't just come because we receive something. I said this a little bit earlier. Generosity also inspires thankfulness in the one who gives. So the one who gets thanks God, and the one who gives begins to thank God as well. Gratitude, generosity inspires thankfulness in the one who gives. And that gratitude gets translated into even more generosity. It's this cyclical effect. It becomes addictive. I'm telling you, when you do it, it's cyclical. You give and you get, and you give and you get. You give and you pass out, and God blesses and you give more, and God blesses some more and you give more, and God blesses and you give, and we give and we feel great, and God blesses so we can give again. Don't be a blessing hoarder. Don't go, God, please bless me. God, rain down your blessings on me. God, I need a blessing today. And when you get blessed, don't go, thanks, God. Appreciate it. Begin to give blessings to others, because God's going to pour out the blessings. So don't hold out that rain bucket and hoard all the blessings. Give. When you are given, you should give. Freely we have received, so freely we should give. Amen. A blessed person should be a blessing to others. When it comes to generosity, see, Paul has a particular way of speaking about it. The words he associates with giving generously are words like abound and increase and enlarge and overflowing and surpassing grace, because when we abound in our generosity, our thankfulness is a natural response. We can't internalize this truth. We can't understand the idea of abounding in generosity and being thankful. We can't internalize the truth until we regularly practice generosity. Some of you going, Pastor, I don't know what you're talking about. Well, to me, that says that you're not practicing generosity. Because if you practice generosity, it becomes addictive and it becomes cyclical. When you give that time, or when you give that money, or when you give in that relationship, or when you give whatever it is that you have to give, remember, it's not always money. Sometimes it can be money, but sometimes it's other things. Whatever you give, and when you receive the blessings from giving, and you receive the blessings from obeying and doing what God has asked you to do, it makes you want to do it even more. It does. It does. Practice makes perfect, if you will. See, God is increasingly generous to us. God doesn't bless us because we deserve what he gives us. Amen? None of us deserve his blessing. We know that, right? Amen? God gives us abundantly because it's in his nature to be generous to his children. And anytime when we think about that idea, when we think about that, what the word says about that, when we think about the generosity, the blessings that God has bestowed on us, anytime we realize how good God has been to us, it becomes obvious that we should act generously with others, because we're thankful for what God did with us. We're thankful no matter what. We know the blessings we've been given. Even if they're not as many as it seems like the person down the street, we know what we've been given. And anytime we realize that, we should be generous with others. Blessed people should bless people. Amen? That needs to be our new phrase, church. It shouldn't be hurt people, hurt people. It should be blessed people, bless people. We need to make a t-shirt out of that. We need to be hashtagging that on Twitter and Facebook right now. Blessed people should bless people. So as we close, you might be wondering, how does this apply to me, Pastor? What do I need to do with this information? How do I apply this to my everyday life? Here's what I want you to do. Here's what I'm asking. Here's what I'm challenging as your pastor. I want you, and I'm going to do this myself. I want us to look to be a blessing this week, today, but every day this week, at least one time a day, we should be a blessing to someone. Find a way to share some of what you have been blessed with. Be blessed and go bless, if you will. Bless someone financially who's going through a hard time. Bless someone relationally who you haven't talked to in a while. Bless someone emotionally that's lost a loved one recently. Man, we know the chaos in our world. We have been blessed, so we should bless. Blessed people should bless people. So be a blessing today, church. Be a blessing this week. Let's be a blessing. Let's take these 50 people, kids, you included, children, listen to me. Be a blessing in your schools this week. Be a blessing to your mom and dad. Parents, be a blessing to your kids. Be a blessing this week. Freely you have received, so freely give. Bless people should bless people. And as we close, I was thinking about this idea of blessing people. And I thought, you know, a pretty big blessing for a lot of us would be if someone gave us a $50 bill. And if someone gave me this $50 bill, I could do a lot of cool stuff with 50 bucks. I could go to McDonald's and I could get a 20-piece McNuggets and all the chicken I want. I could get a double quarter pounder with cheese. I could get that McFlurry. I could get some cookies. I could get a whole bucket of those fries. With 50 bucks, I could eat like a king at McDonald's for a year probably. I could eat, maybe not a year, maybe a week. Let's say that. I could eat like a king for a week with 50 bucks. But what if I took that 50 that I was blessed with and I turned it into 50 blessings for other people? And I went around and I said, bless you and bless you. And I had 50 blessings, $50. I could buy 50 McChickens for 50 different people. See, I could eat like a king for a week. I could hoard it. I could take that blessing and do what I want in my flesh, and I could hoard the blessing for me and for my family. Or I could bless so many others with the blessing that I was given. See, God doesn't bless us to hoard them. He blesses us so that we will spread the blessings around. Hurt people do hurt people. That's a true statement. But there shouldn't be any more true than the statement that blessed people should bless people. So church, today, that's my challenge. I want us to be a blessing. I want us to be a blessing. So today, as we close, as we finish out, maybe today you need a blessing. Maybe you're saying, God, I need what this guy's talking about. I need to know that you love me. I need to know that you're there for me. We'd love for you right now to press that pray with me button. We'd love to pray and bless you. If you need something, let one of us know. We'd love to be a blessing. Maybe that's you today. Or maybe you're even here and you're saying, man, I need to be blessed with knowing that Jesus not just loves me, but he has saved me. He died on the cross for my life. There's no bigger blessing to receive than what Jesus did for us. Let me share that with you today. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus as your Savior, if you're watching this online, man, there's a button right now that we want you to press to accept Jesus as your Savior. We want to pray with you. We want to bless you with the biggest blessing ever as knowing Jesus as your Savior. So if you want to know Jesus today, press that button that you want to receive him, and we will pray with you today. We'd love to pray that with you today. But maybe you're like me. Maybe you've already received that blessing. And now you just want to say, man, God, show me how to be a blessing to someone else. Maybe that's your prayer today. Man, just pray that today. God, this week, my pastor has challenged me, God, so I'm trying to do this, what he's asking. So let me this week, let me not take that $50 and just hoard it for myself. Let me take that $50 and turn it into 50 different blessings for 50 different people. God, help me to be a blessing. Show me where I can be a blessing. Come on, church. Blessed people should bless people. Let's pray. God, I thank you. Lord, first of all, I'm thankful. No matter what happens in my life, no matter if everything else goes wrong in my life from here on out, God, I'm thankful for who you are, for what you've done. I thank you for all the blessings you have rained down in my life. God, I never would have imagined that I would be where I am today. So God, I don't want to take that for granted. Thank you, Lord, for the blessings. But God, I pray this week, Lord, help me to be a blessing to someone else this week. Help me to be a blessing to people that I pass by, God. Help me to be a blessing to my family, to my wife and my kids. Lord, help me to be a blessing to my church, God. Help me to be a blessing wherever I go, wherever I walk, whatever I do, God, help me to be a blessing. And God, right now, I don't know if there's anyone that prayed that they would know Jesus today that hasn't known Jesus before. But if they had, God, I pray they would pray with me that they ask you to come into their heart, to forgive their sins, to be the Lord of their life, that they give you the lead, that you can take control, God, so that they can receive the greatest blessing that's ever been given in your Son, Jesus Christ. And God, I pray that they receive him today and that their life would be forever changed and nothing would ever be the same. Lord, I love you. I praise you. I thank you for our church. Even in these tough times where we can't meet together, God, I thank you that we can meet together this way and we can stay connected. God, I pray you help us stay connected in these next 6 or 8 weeks, God, however long it takes. We pray you keep us connected as a family. God, we love you. We praise you. We honor you in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen, church. I love you guys. Let's take a few moments. Just continue to chat with one another. I know we haven't got to see each other in a while, so let's keep talking and just seeing how everybody is. If anybody needs anything, please let one of the leaders know. Meet us on Zoom in the next week and just talk to us. We love to catch up with you guys. I love you, church. Have a great week. See you soon.
Sorrow, there is an ocean deeper than fear. The tide is rising. messengers, calling all the messengers, calling all the messengers.
Been given a call, been forgiven, risen, we living and give them our all. Rise up from your past, it's holding you down. This moment is all that matters, the future is now. How will the people know if we don't tell them? If we fail them, they stumbling in the dark, but the light is what we carry, yeah. Don't have to wonder your purpose or what you here for. Reflect his image and show the world what he cares for. And I know it's all right, 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 and you know, it's your lie, lie, lie. And we know, the time's running out, can't wait around, cause seen plenty of hatred, death, and destruction where ignorance kills many. The blind leading the blind, we turning the blind eye. That alone is a crime. We got the power of life. I know that we make mistakes, don't let them keep you away. Mercy, love, and His grace is the reason we move ahead. Speak out, though we never been qualified to do it. I ain't earned it, I was loved into it. I'm brand new, yeah. And I know it's all right, right, right. You know, and you know, it's your lie, lie, lie. And we know, the time's running out. Can't wait around, cause
to the table. sinners and these thieves. There's no one unwelcome here. And that sin and shame that you brought with you, you can leave it at the door and let mercy draw you. To the young and to the older, all who hunger, all who thirst, all the last and all the first, all the paupers and the princes, all who failed, you've been forgiven, all who dream and all who suffer, all who loved and lost another, all the chained and all the free, all who follow, to the table.
I've walked among the shadows, you wiped my tears away, and I felt the pain of heartbreak. And I've seen the brighter days, and I've prayed prayers to heaven from my lowest place. And I have held your blessings, God, you give and take away. No matter what I have, your grace is enough. And no matter where I am, I'm standing in your love. On the mountains I will bow my life to the one who set me there. In the valley I will lift my eyes to the one who sees me there. When I'm standing on the mountain, I didn't get there on my own. When I'm walking through the valley, I know I am not alone. You're God of the hills and valleys. Hills and valleys. God of the hills. And I am not alone. I've watched my dreams get broken. In you I hope again. No matter what, I know I'm safe inside your hands. On the mountains I will bow my life to the one who set me there. In the valley I'm standing on the mountain, I didn't get there on my own. When I'm walking through the valley, I know I am not alone. You're God of the hills and valleys, hills and valleys. God of the hills and valleys, and I am not alone. Father, you give and take away
Father, you give.